When the Shah of Iran and his Empress come calling, as they did this week in Washington, the President of the United States really rolls out the red carpet. In these difficult days, more than ever, with his oil, his armed forces, and his influence in the Third World, the Shah of Iran is an ally whose power counts. We have talked to the Shah on 60 Minutes three times. A fascinating man, remarkably candid for a monarch whose rule is close to absolute. And his Empress is just as fascinating. A woman whose intelligence, compassion, and beauty was capturing the world's attention long before oil became gold and before the world began beating a path to Tehran.
Farah Pahlavi, 29 years old, is crowned Empress of Iran. The first woman to be so anointed in the 2,500-year history of the Persian Empire. She had been married 8 years before to the Shah, and 9 months after their wedding, she had produced the long-awaited crown prince, heir to the peacock throne. This coronation was her reward. In the 15 years she has been their queen, Farah has little by little captured the Iranians. Wherever she goes now, whatever the security precautions, she is assaulted with affection. The most underprivileged among her countrymen revere her not just as the holy wife of their godlike sovereign. They worship her as the champion of the oppressed, their voice in the exalted and remote regions of the palace. She has come so long away from her days as Farah Diba, a chubby architecture student, only child of a middle-class Iranian family, chosen by the Shah, when she was 20, as his third wife, to make up for his two previous unhappy marriages which had not produced a son. While there are some who see Farah as a fairy princess, a Cinderella, she takes her job seriously.
I care for everything. This is my problem. Or maybe in a way it's good. In another way it creates too much problem. I go after an idea. I cannot sleep if I don't reach any aim. So if my work is becoming more and more difficult, this is because people bring all this work to me and ask me to enter new fields of this country.
Iranians like to feel they are more European than Oriental, and Farah takes seriously her husband's promise to make Iran the most sophisticated country in Western Asia. She works at it. To match the Shah's economic great leap forward, she has created film and music and theater festivals, and she has animated a sense of pride and purpose among Iranian artists and musicians. Her nights and her days, too, are a kaleidoscope of official chores.
Seem to feel a sense of responsibility. You work very hard at your job, don't you?
Well, I do, because there is so many things to be done in our country, and I'm involved in everything. I can't say that I'm only interested in some fields. You can't say it's like your own home. You're interested in everything which is happening in it. And I have this sense of responsibility, and I know that I'm able to do some things. I have the possibilities. So Every year I get more and more work.
In 1972, the Shah entrusted the Empress with her first foreign mission. She went, without him, to China, an imperial visit to open a dialogue with the Chinese. And there was more to it than mere flags and flowers and chatting children. When she sat across the table from Chou En-lai, she talked of trade and cultural exchange. And she played ping pong, too.
How much actual power do you have as Empress? Or does all of your power stem from your husband?
Well,
That's the first time that you've...
I've been thinking. It's because I have been doing things in so many different fields. It's not because everything which is done in a country is not just by giving an order or being very powerful. This is a matter of discussion with the people in the government, with the people which are qualified in that field. So we decide that this is good for the country.
Don't you have to persuade your husband about some of your own ideas?
Well, sometimes I have to explain to him and to explain and to make them believe in some ideas. I do my own jobs without giving the permission or having an order from the king, but sometimes he has to give the order, so I give him reports. I write him small letters and small notes.
So you do?
Yes.
Under his pillow or under the plate at
the
dinner table?
No, I write it and I send it to his private bureau, and then he gives the order and we discuss about it.
Christmas
happens.
There is speculation not just in Tehran, but in other capitals as well, as to just what the Shah has in mind for the Empress. It is apparent he respects her mightily. He changed the constitution to make her regent, the ruling power, in the event he dies before the crown prince reaches the age of 20. The boy is now 14. And each year, the Shah expands her education, her duties. She receives a budget. She says $6 million a year. Actually, it is unlimited. She has a staff of over 100 persons who manage her leadership over 26 institutes and councils, societies and foundations. Farah has become Iran's unofficial secretary of culture, health, education and welfare. Her private office in downtown Tehran, is flooded with petitioners who write or come themselves to seek money, advice, help with family problems. If the official bureaucracy is wooden, unresponsive, sometimes corrupt, the poor Iranian has learned that Farah and her staff of social workers can serve as ombudsman, can secure entry to a hospital, can help with a small loan.
Can you truly say, Your Majesty, that the bureaucracy in this country does not say behind your back, why doesn't she be a nice, pretty queen and stay out of our business?
I don't think so, because every day I see more people and more people. They come to me and they ask me to help them in different fields, the different new fields that I have to add to my the work that I have. Why? Because I feel that they maybe have confidence in me and I want to do really my job without doing the job of a minister.
Do you really have equal rights for women here?
Of course, legally we have, but like any other countries coming to practice in different branches, it needs time for the people to get used to. And we have, unfortunately, we women, we have to prove that we are good enough, so that men don't have to prove that they are good enough to have work.
Well, women's liberation in the United States and women's liberation in Iran, is there any similarity, really?
There is no similarity because of the difference of two countries, because that we have only 10 years of equal rights, and we are an Asian country with a very old traditions, a very old culture. We have our way of living, and we are still a rural country.
Iranian women were given the vote 12 years ago. Veils have come off and women have finally begun to infiltrate every kind of administrative and technical profession, even the paramilitary literacy corps. created by the Shah to fight Iran's 50% illiteracy rate. After 4 months of military discipline and teacher training, these girls go out to remote country districts. The villagers idolize their empress. Her tours, frequently unannounced, include schools and family planning clinics. She has also multiplied daycare centers throughout Iran. Not a week goes by that Farah doesn't visit one or another hospital that she has had a hand in getting built. And the patients sense that there is more to her visits than just a do-gooder showing the flag.
When you see misery and poverty, you cannot forget that. You can finish your work after 6-5 hours of work every day, but your mind cannot rest. You cannot forget the problems of others. So when we are achieving something great happening, some days I'm very happy, life is beautiful, everybody is nice, and everybody is wonderful, and sometimes I have days, unfortunately, which I'm very down and very depressed, pessimistic about the whole life and the whole world, but fortunately it doesn't remain.
A palace would seem a formidable place in which to live. Especially, perhaps, for one not born to the manor. But Farah manages to minimize formality in her dress, in her person. Her own apartment is filled with her mementos, scrapbooks, souvenirs, the picture albums that she labors to keep up to date. She is a first-rate athlete. The Crown Prince was only the first of her four children, two boys, two girls. She tries to keep their lives as normal as the circumstances permit.
My eldest son and my eldest daughter go to a school which is in the garden of the palace with 25 other children, and we try to keep it as normal as we can. I worry about them, of course, because maybe they have, in a way, a lot of facilities in their life, but they also don't have the freedom that other children of their age have. This is my problem with the security people, to be there but not to make the children feel that they are always around them, because it might be very bad for them when they grow up. They will always rely on someone else. They have to be alone and stand in their own feet.
The children were delighted that their busy father would take 15 minutes on the afternoon of his birthday for a small celebration with them.
There is a hard work, there are so many things to be done, there are sometimes deception, and sometimes it's too difficult. But at the same time, there is a lot of satisfaction when you see that something has been done, you have created a new thing. And when you see the faces of the people, their affection, it's such a great satisfaction.
The girl who is Farah Diba has come an immense way in the 15 years since she was chosen by the Shah, and so have her countrymen. The Shah has promised them that within a decade, his policies and Iran's oil will have propelled Iran past most Western European countries. That can be argued, but no one will dispute the Emperor's role in helping to bring her country into the 20th century. And she has the will and the time to do much more. She is only 36.